The Mars Science Laboratory is designed to spend almost 2 years analyzing rock and soil samples to see if Mars is going to be favorable for microbial life or to preserve any clues they find about possible life that was there in the past. Well, the robotic missions that are like this one are being worked from NASA centers all over the country, and they are stepping stones to future missions to Mars. In fact, right here at the Johnson Space Center, there are teams that are working to develop the food that human crews would eat on a mission that would take them to Mars. And this morning, we're going to learn more about that effort from Dr. Michele Perchonok, who is the Advanced Food Technology Project Scientist. Good morning.
Morning.
How long has NASA been working on issues about food for a mission to Mars?
Well, I've been at NASA for 12 years, and they've been working on it a lot longer than that, so I'm going to say about 20 years.
I assume that we've taken whatever we've learned feeding crews on previous flights, on the space station, space shuttle, and prior missions, is being rolled in here. What are the basics in trying to develop something like this?
Well, we have actually, we call it a two-pronged food system. So first is the packaged food system that we already have and are using on International Space Station. But there's a little bit of a difference. On International Space Station, our food only has to last about 18 months or so.
Go ahead.
But on a Mars mission, they have to last about 5 years. So that takes into account the fact that they'll probably pre-position the food on orbit before the crew gets there, the time it takes for us to make the food, as well as, of course, the time that they have to eat it. Mm-hmm. So 5-year shelf life, not seen anywhere else except maybe our military. The other piece of the food system is once we're on the surface, we can do what we call a bioregenerative food system. That's growing in environmental chambers, fresh fruits and vegetables, either growing or bringing up in bulk things like soybeans, wheat berries, peanuts, and then processing those into ingredients such as tofu or wheat flour into bread or into pasta. And then, of course, the vegetables and fruit can be used for just pick and eat or to process maybe into a tomato sauce or into cooked vegetables. So the packaged food side of things, yes, we have some experience, but we have to go further. But the bioregenerative side, we're really doing very little of that right now.
Are you thinking in terms of growing it in the soil on Mars, growing food there?
No. So the thought is that we will instead be using environmental chambers, which will control the temperature, the humidity, the lighting, and then they would be growing hydroponically so that we can recycle the water and nutrients would be put into the water. And also, because these chambers are limited in size, we would probably also be looking at dwarf-like plants, so smaller
tiny
versions.
Vegetables.
Well, cherry tomatoes instead of regular tomatoes, because cherry tomato plants might only grow 1 to 2 feet, whereas regular tomato plants could grow 4 feet or so.
In thinking about this, I was thinking in terms of feeding a crew on the way to Mars. And that sounds to me like there are certain things you just have to do without because you can't refrigerate and you can't carry that much.
Right. So on the way to Mars, which is about a 6-month trip, and on the way home, which is also a 6-month trip, providing that the planets are aligned in their closest orientation, we would use a food system very similar to International Space Station. So it would be a packaged food system where there are individually packaged items for each crew member. So it would be a serving of meatloaf or a serving of broccoli au gratin. And they would just basically rehydrate or heat that food.
Is there enough, how much space does that much food for that size crew take up?
It's a lot. So if you assume, and we don't know the crew size, but if you assume a crew of 6 and you assume a 1,000-day mission, then we're talking about almost 20,000 or about 20,000 pounds of packaged food. Now, that doesn't assume any of the bioregenerative part. 20,000 pounds of food, the volume, we calculated that, and we think it's about the amount of 3 large refrigerators full. So we're talking about a small room or a large closet worth of food. So Doesn't sound like a lot, but that's really, really, really tightly packed.
Apparently. It would seem to me that it would have to take up a lot more room than that.
Gut feel, yes. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we've done the calculations. And again, it's taking into a lot of assumptions that we don't necessarily know the real answer. So how is it going to be packaged? Are there going to be racks or other sort of secondary places to stow them? In that case, it would take more room. So that kind of information we don't have yet. So this is clearly just the food, nothing else. So if you're going to pack it into something and then pack it into something else, or you have to add foam to it that to protect the packaging, that all is extra space.
When you're thinking about being able to provide a crew with all the vitamins and minerals and nutrients that they need, do you assume that it all comes from meals that they eat, or are there other supplements that help you do that?
So currently on ISS, International Space Station, the only supplement that the crew is required to take is vitamin D, because the only way to really get vitamin D in any quantity is from the sun.
Sunshine.
And obviously, they're not having any sunshine. There are ways in the food to do it, but not as easily. We have to make the assumption to try to give them all the nutrients they need, all of the vitamins and minerals and protein, carbohydrate, fat, calories, etc., through the food, because ironically, or much more of a challenge, is the fact that nutrients in a pill actually break down faster than the nutrients in the food. So chemistry happens whether it's in a pill form or the food form. It seems like that matrix in the food is actually protecting the vitamins. So if we can bring up enough food with enough quantity of vitamins and minerals in that food, we're okay. The problem is, in the packaged food system, to make sure it's stable without a refrigerator or freezer, we have to process it. And that process often will be partly heat to kill the microorganisms, irradiation to kill them, or drying it down to allow so that the microorganisms can't grow. Now, we have new technologies we're looking at, microwave sterilization, high pressure, which look at killing the microorganisms either by through the pressure of breaking the cell structure or microwaves. But either way, we're introducing a step that can kill the not only the microorganisms, but some of the nutrients. So we have that challenge in there.
And that's part of what we do in the station food now, with the freeze-dried food and thermostabilized
food. Correct. All of that is already on station. And one of our studies is looking at not only how much of the nutrients you lose through the processing, but then if you look at them at ambient or room temperature storage for 1 year or 3 years, how much more are you losing? Because unfortunately, that chemistry continues to happen, and we lose more nutrients.
Does that mean you have to add more nutrients to them ahead of time to account for the degradation?
So that's one way to do it, and we would call that fortification. And actually, in our beverages that are fortified, because the beverages were dried and then you add the vitamins to it, they actually do maintain more vitamin stability. Mm. The other way is now to protect those vitamins. Can you encapsulate them? Can you do something else to them so that they are more protected? And think of it as almost like in a shell, so that they don't react with the water or the oxygen out there and allow them to stay more stable for longer periods of time.
It's very interesting to think about that down to the details, but we've sucked all the excitement out of food, too. The crew member's going to get bored having what I guess is a narrow selection over the course of 2 or 3 years?
So that is another study we're doing, is looking at how much variety do you need? How can you sort of mix it up a little bit with different condiments? How do you make it more special with extra, you know, special meals, whether it's holidays or birthdays or just say it's the first Sunday of the month? But right now, we have about 180 food items on International Space Station, and that seems to be, well, and then we have another 100 or so items from Russia and some more from Europe. So we're probably at about a 300 number. And that seems to be the right number for a six-month mission. What do you need for a two-and-a-half-year mission? And that's one of the reasons why we're looking at this bioregenerative food system, because it introduces a little bit more variety. It introduces a little bit more creativity. Well, you know, tonight I'm going to put in my pasta sauce bell peppers, but not onions. And the next night I'm going to put in onions and not bell peppers. So it's a little bit different. But yes, they are going to get bored. It's not like here on Earth where we can say, I don't feel like eating anything out of my refrigerator, so I'm going to go to a restaurant mm-hmm. tonight.
If you get bored with the food, as a crew member might in this circumstance, do you find that they don't eat as much as they're supposed to?
That is what we're finding, that they don't eat as much when they're bored with the food, if the acceptability of the food goes down. And that's a big concern because this food allows them to perform well, keep healthy, and more importantly, it helps to mitigate the bone loss and muscle mass loss that they do experience in microgravity.
What kind of things do you have on the menu at this point? If we were launching to Mars tomorrow, what kind of food would be available for a crew?
Well, right now, of our 60-plus thermostabilized items, which is basically canned food in a pouch, only seven of them have a five-year shelf life. Mm-hmm. And they all happen to be meat items. So brisket, pork chops, meatloaf. So not a lot of variety. But we're working towards trying to get that improved and making sure that they have a good variety of items, just like they do on International Space Station, from chocolate pudding cake for dessert to having scrambled eggs or a cinnamon scone for breakfast, and fruit, strawberries or whatever. So we're working towards it.
Now, in this case, we've got maybe 20 years or more before we're ready to make that trip. Is that why we need to be preparing the menu now for a trip that doesn't launch until the 2030s?
Well, you're right. We have a lot of time. However, the bioregenerative food system piece, we're estimating could take at least 10, if not 15 years to develop, because not only do we have to determine what we want to do with it, what we want to grow, but then what do you need to process and what equipment do you need for that? And you'll have a galley that I describe as a sort of a 21st century galley, but with 15th century operations, because you may have a juicer or a food processor, but meanwhile, if you're making bread, you're either going to have to knead it by hand or have a bread maker. Or if you want grated carrots, you're going to have to grate them. You can't go to the grocery store and pick up those grated carrots. So there's a lot involved with the bioregenerative food system. So what we're trying to do is say, okay, we're going to sort of put that out in the future and not necessarily do it right away. But right now, let's look at that packaged food system. Because if we can extend the shelf life now, that makes that, if you think about it, if you get a higher quality food up front so that it's still good in 5 years, think about how good it would be in 1 year or 2 years for International Space Station. Mm-hmm. So we're working on that first. We hope to have a 5 year shelf life system, food system ready. Knowing how to do it, not necessarily having developed all those 200-plus products by about 2020. And then we can take some time to develop all those formulations. We don't call them recipes. We call them formulations.
It's all very interesting, and be interesting to see how it turns out, what comes up next. Thanks for bringing us up to date on that.
You're welcome.
Michele Perchonok is the Advanced Food Technology Project Scientist.